Looks like, you know, there are more people coming in. So, should I minimize this stuff in here? Minus. Okay. So I'm gonna start on this one. Now, how many, I guess maybe the first question of this class, so pretty much what I'm gonna focus today. What I'm gonna focus today is on, let me see here. Everybody. I'm gonna focus today, it's pretty much processing point cloud data, you know, and get your surfacing still pretty, I mean, it is like, you know, how you get the surface from point cloud. Now, the point cloud data, like, you know, that I'm using in a stuff, you know, is more or less, I mean, it's like open, I guess, open source. What was the standard for like point cloud data? That's the LS files. Now, if everybody knows by now, but in Silk D, starting with, I don't know which version was that one, maybe 2018, 17 and stuff, they removed the LS, like, you know, the capability to use LS files right in Silk D. So because of that one, you have to figure out like, you know, a different way to make it work and stuff, yeah. Now, if you use the order of the software and stuff, you know, there's a way to make it work, you know, but you have to use the AEC collection. So pretty much, you know, if you use the AEC collection, there are two pieces of software that are used together to get you the data, like, you know, from a LS file to a specific one specifically uses. Now, how many people here do they want a subscription to RGS Pro for, you know, SV product? Anybody? No. Okay, so pretty much, you know, I'm gonna show like, you know, so what I'm gonna do right now, like for example, I'm gonna show you the GIS way, the RGS way, this is the, pretty much the paid way, the fast way, but it gets you the fastest result and stuff. And then I'm gonna show you like, you know, how to do it the other way. I mean, like, you know, the, like going through multiple versions of software and get you the data in this, almost in the same, you know, in the same way. So what I'm gonna have in here, I'm gonna start with this project in here. So if I look in here, I have like just an outline of my project in here, pretty much, you know, just kind of give me a location for the project. Now, if everybody looks in here, they might know where this is located. This one is downtown. So I'm pretty much, you know, for our purposes today, I'm looking to demoing, you know, pretty much, you know, how to get the data for a specific location in here. Yeah. So what I'm gonna do in here, this is my cat file, you know, it's called cat file and stuff. This is stapling, you know, Texas 83 CF. So pretty much it's a stapling file. The area of it I'm using here, it's the Bing ADL imagery that comes with your Autodesk subscription. So if you have an Autodesk account, you can pretty much, you know, turn on the ADL as long as, you know, your cat file has a coordinate system assigned to it. So right here I have the cat file. And if I want to see like, you know, where is this some position located, I can go to the geolocation. So the geolocation tab, it's enabled only if your cat file has a coordinate system assigned to it. So you can go to the geolocation tab and I can go here to the map and I can turn on, you know, one for aerial or hybrid or so. So I'm gonna use, you know, here the map aerial and there you go. Now, of course, with this being aerial image, you can also like save it, like, you know, this kind of like, you know, the aerial image, you know, in the cat file, but it's saved in a format, you know, that's pretty much stored in the cat file. Yeah. But, you know, that's not the subject of today. So for today, it's like, I'm gonna look, you know, for AI here to get my data. So my project, you know, I'm gonna say first things first, you know, like in order for me to get the data for a specific area, I'm gonna want first to define the outline of the surface that I want to bring in. So pretty much I'm gonna define how much surface I want to bring in. So to do that one in here, like, you know, this is position here, and I'm gonna figure out like that maybe the area that I want to bring in, it's I'm gonna define it as a rectangle. And I'm gonna define, you know, okay, I want to bring in all the data for this section right in here. Yeah, so this one defined, then in RGS Pro, like, you know, I'm not gonna use the cat file, I'm gonna use a shape file of, you know, this area. So for me, you know, to go with generating, you know, the shape file, I'm gonna use a map export. And I'm gonna say map export, you can ask me what I want to export. The location, I'm gonna put it in here on my GIS folder in here, this is where I'm working, and I'm gonna give it a name, so this is the outline, I guess, and I'm gonna put it in stapling SPC right there. Now click OK. And then from here, I'm gonna say like the object type here is selected, it has to be a polygon. I mean, you can put it as a line, you're gonna just see a bunch of lines and stuff, you know, but I'm using a polygon. I'm gonna see a select manually. I'm gonna click on this filter and I'm gonna select, you know, this object right in here. I'm gonna right click to accept the selection. And if you did it the right way, you're gonna see here on the bottom, it says one object selected, zero filtered up. It means if you'd have seen one object selected, one filtered out, it means, you know, you didn't, you know, your polyline is not actually polygon. It's like, it might be not close and stuff, yeah. So one object selected, zero filtered out, and for you to explore it, you're gonna go to the options in here. And then for RGS to recognize this object, you know, because, you know, AutoCAD has a concept of polygons. I mean, you might have a concept called polygons, but, you know, in order for, you know, this polyline to be treated as a polygon in RGS, you have to select in here and say treat closed polylines as polygons. And then I'm gonna click okay. Now the extent it's, you know, it, the area it's, you know, pretty much, you know, it's exported to shapefile, then I can go in here and start RGS Pro. So right in here, I'm gonna start RGS Pro. And I'm using RGS Pro. Why I'm using RGS Pro and I'm using RMAP is because RGS Pro is the one that's replacing RMAP. Pretty much, you know, pretty much S3, they're gonna deprecate RMAP. They're gonna, you know, get rid of it. So because of that one, pretty much, you know, going forward, RGS Pro is the software to use, you know, in the S3 environment and stuff. So I'm gonna use here RGS Pro. I'm gonna, let me see here, minus of this stuff. I'm gonna start without a template for now, because I don't care about, you know, creating a template, you know, creating a, you know, like a project. I just wanted to use it for processing purposes. So right in here, I have my project started, and I'm gonna say here, I'm gonna go into the insert. I'm gonna insert here a new map. So pretty much I'm gonna generate a new map within this project. And right in here, if you have, like, you know, access to, like, you know, some base maps, you're gonna see that, you know, it's populated. Now this one is populated with this, you know, Austin area base map, because, you know, this is how it's connected to my RGS online. So because of that one, I get all this data right in here, yeah. Now in here, what I'm gonna do in here, I'm gonna look, you know, for the data that I have. And the data that I have it here under the GIS folder. And you're gonna see that I have like two LAS files. So this pretty much, you know, the data, it's the data that I got, you know, from the point cloud data. As I said before, like, you know, these ones you can, you should be able to get them from the city, like, you know, on request. So because of that one, I would say, like, you know, these ones are available, public available. It's not, they're not published on, you know, on an FTP or some stuff, because, you know, the amount of data, it would be like too much to be hosting. So because of that one, typically city and stuff requires for, like, you know, like LiDAR data or Arial to be in, let's say, like, you know, for you to get it, you know, on a, like a hard drive or so. But, you know, this one applies, you know, let's say you don't have, like, you know, the stuff in the city, this one applies to any stuff. You know, if you get the LS file from a server or that kind of stuff, you know, it's the same, you know, concept of this one. Now in here, we're gonna look, you know, pretty much you're gonna investigate this strat map, you know, this about two LS files. We're gonna try to, you know, bring this data in RGS, because we try to, you know, use it for processing purposes. So for me, you know, to start in this project, I'm gonna connect, first on the project, I'm gonna connect to the folder. And the folder for this one, it's under the C drive. So here I define a favorites, and I'm gonna say here add the project. And in here under the C drive, under GIS, first things are gonna look, you know, the data to see, like, you know, hey, this data, what coordinate system is, or that kind of stuff, yeah? So I'm gonna go in here, I'm gonna look at it, I'm gonna right click on one of these LS files, I'm gonna go to properties. And based on these properties, I can go in here and coordinate system and see that this actual data is in NAD 83, UTM is 14 north, and, you know, the linear unit is feet. And I've also the vertical one, it's also the linear unit, it's meters, and the vertical, it's also like meters. So the vertical right in here, it's in meters. Now this is the, is an atypical for the city, because typically the city gets their unstable and stuff. But at this time, you know, this is the 2017 LiDAR data. When this one is provided, it was provided in UTM 14 North. And because of this one, you have a little bit of processing to get the data in state plane and in US survey feed, yeah. So in here, I'm gonna, first things first, I'm gonna pretty much bring my, you know, state plane, you know, shapefile right in here. Now, before I do this stuff in here, I'm gonna define my coordinate system for my map. So I'm gonna say coordinate system, and I'm gonna define it to be the NADS, the state plane. That's good. Okay, so that's fine, click okay. So in here, I'm gonna go in here and drag, you know, this outline state plane. I'm gonna drag it in here. I'm gonna see if it positions myself right in the area of my project, yeah. So based on this outline, I'm supposed to bring data, you know, pretty much all this one in here. So what I'm gonna do with this one is the following. I'm gonna zoom to the object in here. I got Suzu to the lab. It's good on this stuff. So how do I bring this data in here? Like, you know, because, you know, for me to process this data, you know, I have to bring it in, you know, RGS and then process it. Now RGS, like RGS Pro and stuff, doesn't process data like straight from an LS file. You have to build the LSD file. Now what's an LSD file? A LSD file, it's an index file for, like, you know, lots of LS files, yeah? So because of that one, you know, I'll have to build the LSD file and add this LS file to that one, and then I can use the LSD file, yeah? So under the GIS in here, I'm gonna right click on here, I'm gonna say I'm gonna build a new LS data set right here. And I'm gonna leave it as it is right now, for now. And to this one, I'm gonna right click on this one and say properties. And I'm gonna go here in LS files, I'm gonna add, you know, the LS files that I have from here. So I'm gonna go to the C drive. And I'm gonna go here to GIS and add this two strand map files, click okay, open in here. That added. Now the current system of this LSD file, it's also the 40 north, so pretty much it matches the one of your, like, component LS files. So I have the LSD data set, so I'm gonna bring this one, I'm gonna drag and drop it in the window in here. So by dragging and drop it, you know, the stuff, you know, spins in here, and you're gonna see that the data is loaded. Maybe I'm gonna change, you know, this outline in here to display a little bit better. Like, you know, to kind of have an idea how this one looks and stuff. So right now I have all this data. Now this data, if you look at, you know, if I look at the data, all this data, it is pretty much is the whole point cloud. It includes like ground shots, it includes like vegetation and all that stuff. So for me to process this data, first things first, I have to generate only the ground data. Pretty much I have to filter the data. So to do that one, I'm gonna select, you know, my LSD file. I'm gonna go here to properties, and the properties are gonna go to LS filter, and I'm gonna say here to use only the ground data. So click OK. So I'm gonna pretty much, I'm gonna use only the ground data. The stuff we're gonna update in here to show only the ground data, and you're gonna see if it's only the ground, because, you know, right in here in the area of the building, there's no data. Now once I have this data right in here, I'm gonna start using some geoprocessing tools to process the data. So the first step to, you know, in RGS to get you, like, you know, like the first step, the way I call it, you know, from RGS to CL3D data, is pretty much is converting the LSD data set into a raster. So to do that one, I'm gonna go here to analysis, I'm gonna say tools, and I'm gonna, under the tools, I'm gonna go in here, find this, it's called an LS data set to raster, right in here. So I'm gonna double click on this one. Now I'm here for the input LS data set, I'm gonna use in here, I'm gonna use the LSD file. For the output raster in here, I'm gonna go and browse and generate myself. I'm gonna do it in here under the C drive, under the GIS. I'm gonna keep one here, like I said, like this is like the topo. Pretty much I'm gonna put like the topo. And typically when you generate the raster, you do it, you know, on a grid, you know, because, you know, pretty much use all the data, but it's sampled on the grid. So I'm gonna say this is topo on a 10-foot grid, yeah? Topo 10, and I'm gonna put this .tiff, very divert, click save. Now I'm gonna use the elevation. So pretty much, you know, from the data I'm using the elevation. The interpolation type in here, you don't use a binning, use a triangulation. Interpolation method in here, it's a natural neighbor. And then in here, I'm gonna put the cell size set to a 10. Now, if everything looks fine in here, I should be able to say run. But, you know, I have to think about this stuff. You know, the data from the LSD data set is not in state plane. It's in UTM 14 of meters. So if I process the raster the way it's right now, the data are gonna be generated in UTM 14 north meters. And because of it one, I have to do an extra step by going here to the environments. And then on the environments, I'm gonna set the output coordinate system for me to be state plane. So I'm gonna put the same as the current map. And you can see that, you know, by doing that one, it's, you know, populates the state plane. Then the process extended here, I don't want to process the whole data. I just want to process the area within my display. So I'm gonna put the process extent in here to be the same as current display extent. So right there, you know, I'm done with this stuff. So I'll put my state plane in feet and all that stuff. So I'm gonna go back to parameters and I'm ready to run it. So I'm gonna say here, run. So the data is processed. You're gonna see like it processes like, you know, whatever, 8 million points and stuff. Now, the difference between RGS Pro and RMAP is that RGS Pro is a 64-bit software. RMAP was a 32-bit software, so pretty much technically RGS Pro should take advantage of all the processing power of your machine, you know, the hyper-threading and all that stuff, yeah. So it goes for this one. Okay, it might take a little bit. I have lots of data in here, looks like. Any questions up to here? If no questions, I'm waiting on this one to be done. Okay, so process like there, 30 million points. So maybe you build like 20 million points per quad, because I have two quads put together in one. Okay, come on. Okay, come on, come on, come on. I guess it's waiting, but it's a waiting game all the time. So hopefully by 12:30, we should be done with this part of the workflow, and then we can look at the other one. Okay, points raster is updating, and very good, I have my raster. Now this raster, like, you know, once I generate the raster and stuff, I'm gonna go the extra step of pretty much, you know, because the idea is like, you know, I can, you know, export, you know, the, I can, you know, I can use the whole data in here, but the idea is like, you know, all I want is the data within the rectangle. Okay, updating. I guess I have too many things open. Come on. So there you go, I have my raster in here. This is a 10 by 10 foot grid. And if I zoom out a little bit in from here, I'm gonna pretty much turn up the LSD in here. If I zoom out, you're gonna see that all the AI is processed within that, you know, within that boundary universe, you know. So that's why if you have a LSD file of like the whole city, you want to process, you know, only the area within like within the display. Now I have the raster processed. What I'm gonna do here, I'm gonna clip, you know, the raster based on this outline. So I'm gonna go in here, let me see, raster functions. I got the raster functions, and in here I'm gonna use a clip function. So I'm gonna go in here and data management, and I'm gonna do here clip. So the clip in here is gonna be the raster gonna clip, you're gonna be the top of 10 TIFF. The clipping will be done outside, and the geometry used for clipping will be the outline. I'm gonna say use input feature, I'm gonna say create a new layer. And now if I go over here, turn up the topo, you can see that I have only the raster, this clip. Now this one, it's a temporary one because it's just a clip, you know, in the project. So with this one done, I'm ready to go to the next step. And now here you might have if you have a T file, it's more or less like a DM, you know, you can say like, you know, I want to go right to straight to the CL3D. Now I've seen lots of stuff with CL3D, the issue that, you know, if you use a DM for a surface, it adds an offset, you know, like, you know, in the surface because of the cell, you know, like spacing and stuff. So because of it, one is like, you know, and typically I want to keep the data like, you know, in a, like a text file or some stuff, you know. So I'm going an extra step in here, like pretty much two extra steps. One of them would be like to generate, you know, a point and the centroid of each of these cells, yeah? So I'm gonna generate a point, an elevation point, and the centroid of the cell. By doing this stuff, I'm gonna have a 10 by 10 foot grid, you know, shape file, you know, or point file. So I'm gonna go here to like tools. So I'm gonna say here to, let me see here, raster to point, right there. The input raster gonna be the clip, the field will be the value, and the output point feature, I'm gonna put it in here under the C drive GIS. I'm gonna put in here to call it topo 10, and this is gonna be shapefile, right there. Click save, and I'm gonna say run it. So what it does, it takes that raster and generates the points for that one. Now you have a shapefile. In CL3D, you should be able, I guess, you know, to create, you know, a point from a GIS there, yeah. So you have like, you know, obviously, you know, 10 by 10 foot grid right in here, yeah. Now this one, so it's like, you know, I don't want to use a shapefile, you know, for CL3D to generate a GIS surface. I want to use a text file. So in here, for me to, you know, to use a text file, I have to use another geoprocessing tool where I'm going to export all this point data, the shapefile, to, you know, to an ASCII file. So it could be another tool in here, and this are going to be like, you know, export attributes to ASCII right in here. And I'm going to use in here, I'm going to use pretty much, let me go in here, starting. Okay, so input feature class would be my topo shapefile. I'm using the grid code, and the grid code, you wonder why is the grid code. So if I go in here to the home, to the map, and I'm going to go in here to the locate, and I'm going to find in here this object. Now you see that this object, you know, it's a point 11269 in the stuff, and has a FID, a point ID, and a grid code. Now grid code for you, it's your elevation. So I'm going to go back to the geoprocessing. I'll use the grid code. The delimiter here, it's a comma because the space. And I'm going to go in here and put it, you know, on my C drive. GIS. And then in here, I'm going to call it as pretty much be like topo 10. And I'm going to put it as .csv. Pretty much it's a CSV file. God, CSV. Click save. And I'm going to say here run. So pretty much what this one does in the background, it exports, you know, each point, it's X, Y, and then the Z value is the grid code, yeah? So that's what it does in the background. So now pretty much I'm done with ArcGIS. I can go back to my cat file, right in here. And I can create a surface. So how would I create a surface? I'm gonna go to the star menu. I'm gonna use a template here for my surface. And the one I'm using in here to be like one of my templates for, you know, survey. So see project right here, project this side. Now here, I can create the surface object. I already have one in here, but then I can create a new surface object if needed. So I'm gonna go in here. I guess everybody should know by now, you know how to create the surface object. So I'm gonna go here to the tool space. I have a surface right in here. It's already created. It's waiting just for the points. But you know, in case, you know, I'm gonna just create a new surface. So I'm gonna go here, create a surface. And in here, I'm gonna give it a name. So this will be like, you know, V topo. So pretty much is my existing topo or however you wanna call it. Click okay. I guess I already have a VTOP, also a VTOP one, this stuff. And to this one, I'm gonna add the point file. So I'm gonna say add, and I go here to browse, and I'm gonna find in here the point file from the C drive on the GIS. Topo is a CSV file. Now this one has to be parsed, you know, to be understood by CL3D. So in here, I have a specific point file format called COXYZ. How to define this one? It's easier to go in here, like, you know, into the manage formats. You can go in here, you can create a new one. And you see, like, you know, what pretty much what it looks like. It's easting, northing, elevation. So pretty much it's X, Y, Z, yeah? That's what you define. So I'm using that format. And then I'm gonna see, like, you know, so pretty much, you know, based on this slide, gonna give, it gives also a preview. You have a X, Y, and Z, and click okay. So the data, it's like pretty much, you know, it will be like done. So if I do it here in a zoom extend, this is my surface. I can go here, save. So this would be like, you know, surface from ArcGIS. There you go. So if I go in here to my cat file, I can reference that one in, and I'll have a surface. So pretty much, you know, I had the LiDAR file. Pretty much my LiDAR files were into UTM 14 north in meters. Now those ones have been converted, you know, to like a raster, and the transformation has been applied from UTM north meters to state plane. Now that raster was generated from the raster generated a shapefile of points, like in the century of each cell. And then, you know, that shapefile was exported using the export attribute feature to ASCII to a CSV file. So what happens, you know, down the road, like, let's say, what happens down the road, you know, if I want, you know, let's say, like, you know, okay, this surface maybe is not enough, maybe I need more data. I can go through the same process, export a new outline, go, you know, pretty much go to my raster file, clip it to the new location, and go for the same stuff. And at the end, pretty much what I get at the end, it's another text file. I can override the text file. I can go on this base file and just rebuild the surface. And the surface is gonna have the new location. Now you would say, why didn't I use the whole data? So because, you know, in our map in here, if I go in here, like, you know, why did I clip and stuff? So you see, like, here I have all these VTOPO and stuff in here. Why didn't you use this stuff in here? So the other stuff, you know, if I generate this stuff in here, is like, you know, I try to keep, like in CL3D, we try to keep, you know, the amount of data to the minimum needed. You know, you don't want to bring more data, and then, because they'd be like, you know, if I bring like a big surface, you know, in CL3D, and then I use, you know, the bungee to trim the data in the surface will still be from all those millions of points, But, you know, it's like, you know, the bunch just, you know, clips, you know, the extent displayed, yeah? So because it was like, and I do not use, like, I just like pretty much, you know, maintaining the data, like the consistency. I keep, you know, only the amount of data, or I bring only the amount of data that I need, yeah? So this is pretty much the workflow using ArcMap, yeah? So if you have an ArcMap subscription and stuff, or RGS Pro subscription, you know, you can generate the surface using, you know, using this workflow that I just showed. So any questions to this stuff before we go to the next one? I guess everybody should, you know, I mean, you can go back and ask questions afterwards, like in Discord and also, yeah. Now, the other option is the other option is like, I don't have RGS Pro, what do I do? Here I have like the data from the city, what do I do with it? You know, it's like, how can I make it, you know, so I can get, you know, a surface out of that one, yeah? Now, you can go you can go online and find some stuff and the stuff, but for me, it's like, I'm looking for data that do not have, I mean, I'm looking for tools that I do not have to pay for. You already pay for AEC collection, so you should be able to use the stuff, you know, but you know, the data that you use, the data you deal with, it's an LS file, yeah? Now, SIL3D, like, you know, like the SIL3D, the LS file, it's in a different coordinate system, but you know, what you actually work with, yeah? Now, you could convert the LS file to, let's say, you can convert the whole LS file to, like, you know, so my offer for AutoCAD, like, you know, to not use, you know, RGS and stuff, involves two pieces of software, actually, involves three pieces of software. The first one is the AutoCAD SIL3D. The second one is ReCap, because, you know, SIL3D, like, in order to get to use the data from a point cloud, has to use the ReCap format, so you have to use ReCap. And the third one is the, you know, it's a third-party tool, you know, that's free up to a point, like some tools of it, you know, are free. And I'm gonna show those ones, you know, in the workflow here. That one is called LS Tools, yeah. So I'm gonna go with this process and I'm gonna see, like, how do I get this one done. Now, why do not convert, you know, this file straight, you know, in ReCap? You know, why do not have stuff? That's because, you know, the point cloud is classified, you know, but in ReCap, you know, as far as I know, there's no way for me to remove, you know, classification and just process one of them, yeah. So for me, what I'm trying to do right now, I'm trying to remove anything else except the ground shots, you know, for processing purposes. So, which is the first tool I'm using? So right now I'm gonna go in here, I'm gonna go to the tool that I'm using. So what I'm saying in here, you can go like to Google and just go to Google, and you know, if you type google.com and you're gonna find it here, look for LS Tools, LS Tools. This is the tool, yeah, I'm using LS Tools. You're gonna go here to Rapid Lasso and you're gonna download the LS Tools. Now pay attention, because this one, it's a free and paid kind of feature, you know, like some tools of them that, you know, you have to have a license for it, while some of them they are free to use, yeah. And the ones that I'm focusing on, they're the ones that I'm free to use. So if I look in here at, you know, which I, so the idea is I can always look the license agreement, because, you know, you want to use, you know, you want to, you know, give the credits to what's supposed to give the credits, yeah. So you don't want this stuff. So right now, if I go to the license agreement for LS Tools, you're gonna see that in here, this part of LS Tool is free, open source. So if you want to, you know, stuff, you know, you can contact stuff. So pretty much, you know, I can use this one as a free open source. This also free, but you know, it's not available in open source. And this one's the following LS Tools require licensing for any commercial, government, and so on, yeah. So pretty much the ones I'm gonna look, the tools I'm gonna use from the tools I'm gonna use from the LS Tools are these ones right in here, yeah. I'm gonna use those ones. So I download the LS Tools. So, and when you download the LS Tools, it comes as a zip file. So if I go here to the downloads, you're gonna see that here I have LS Tools, it's a zip file. If I go inside the zip file, it's pretty much a bunch of data and stuff, you know, and you know, pretty much the only data that you use from here is located under the bin folder, yeah. And there are lots of exe files that, you know, some of them you can use also command lines, but the ones I'm gonna use the, you know, the GUI version of it. So pretty much the user interface version. But you know, it gives you a better idea of, like, you know, what you're dealing with. So the LS Tools, I place them in my OneDrive because I like to have it as a portable. And I'm gonna go here to LS Tools, and right in here, I'm gonna go to the bin. And the first tool I'm gonna use from here is pretty much, you know, it's called LS to LS. So what I'm doing with LS to LS, I'm taking the LS data as an input and I'm exporting to another LS data. So, and why I'm doing this stuff, pretty much, you know, I'm using the LS Tools to pass, you know, using as a pass through to, you know, to classify, or, you know, to remove, you know, or to extract only the ground classification. The ground classification, you know, based on the LS file classification, or the standard for ground is number 2, is the classification number 2, yeah. So the class number 2 is the ground So how I'm gonna do about Vitron, I'm gonna go here to LS to LS, double click on this one. I'm gonna say, ask you to run it. I'm gonna run it. And right away, you know, pops up on the top, and this is what it looks like. So it's like, okay, so what I'm doing, what am I doing here? So pretty much you have to start, you go from the left to the right and go through the whole stuff. So I'm gonna go, first things first, I'm gonna browse for those two LS files, yeah? In here, we don't deal with an LSD file, with like an index. We deal straight to the files, the LS files. So I'm gonna go here to the browse, and I'm gonna go here, where are my LS files? I'm gonna go here to the C drive, and I'm gonna say go. So when I go to the C drive, I can see my data on the C drive. I go to the GIS folder, and here I see the two objects, yeah? Now let's say, like, you know, if by any chance you don't know, like, you know, you have the LS files, you know, how do you figure, like, you know, what coordinate system variant? I mean, like, you know, it's like, is there any way to figure out? I'm gonna show you, like, how to figure out that one. There's a tool here, it says LS2Info. So LS info, where is LS to shape? Let me go in here. LS. So I would say you run the LS info first, because you want to know, like, what the data and what's, you know, based on. So I'm gonna go here to the C drive. So I'm gonna go to this one, the first one, the C drive. I'm gonna say go. I'm gonna go here to the GS folder, and I select one of these objects. You know, you're gonna see, like, you know, if I select the object, and it pops up in, you know, it pops in the dialog in here, and you can see if I go in the bottom here, it tells me it's in, actually it's UTM-14 north, and it's in meters. So pretty much, you know, this is like the coordinate system you're working with is UTM-14 north meters. So I'm gonna close the tone, I'm gonna go back to this one, you know, knowing that it's UTM-14 north meters. I'm gonna say, okay, I'm gonna add, you know, the two objects to my view in here. So I'm gonna double click on the first one, and I'm gonna double click on the second one. So there you go, I have all this stuff, yeah. Now, if you remember, like in RGS Pro, I said, like, you know, I want to use, you know, a boundary as like an extent, you know, because I don't want to process all this data, you know, I don't want to classify all this stuff, or, you know, you extract only the classification for all this area. So because of that one, I was like, you know, how do I get in here the extent of what I want to bring in? So the answer to that one, it's found in here. It says overlays. In here, you can see that I can add an overlay, and the way it's a shapefile. Now it's good to know that the LS tools, they do not have a concept of on the fly reprojection of data. So you cannot bring data from multiple, like, you know, coordinate systems in the same place together. Yeah, and because of that one, my outline for my surface, it has to be like pretty much, you know, in the same projection as my LiDAR data. So I'm gonna go in here, and I was like, okay, this is my outline. So how I'm gonna do? I'm gonna say map export. I go here, map export, then I'm gonna go and see if I, you know, I'm gonna say here, I'm gonna use maybe another top outline, and this is gonna put it as UTM 14 North. So it's the outline in UTM 14 North. Click OK. I'm gonna select, you know, the same object, polygon. I'm gonna select it right in here. Now in here, I'm gonna say, like, you know, I'm gonna go to the options, you know, again, the same way as before, three close polygons and polygons. And the only stuff I have to do in here is to say convert coordinates to what? So I'm gonna go in here and find the UTM 14 north. So I'm gonna say here UTM, let me say UTM 14 north. Does it find anything? Or space 14 north. Let me see 14 north, something 14 north. Okay, so I've been here something, and it looks like I found it right in here is the UTM 84 14 north. So it's based on WGS84 18 north. I'm gonna say select it. So based on this stuff, you know, so if you remember this code, you know, you can just type that code in and it should be worded the same way. And I say here, click OK. Now the shapefile, you know, is generated, and now you have a shapefile in UTM 14 north. So I can go here to the shapefile, and I'm gonna go here and find the UTM 14 north, and I'm gonna double click on this one. And there you go. That's the extent of actually what I'm trying to bring in. So I have an outline of what I'm trying to bring in, and I have like the two LS files. So what I'm gonna do in here, I'm gonna go from the top down, and it's like, okay, the first things first, I'm gonna filter the data. I do not want to use all the data. I want to use, you know, only the data, the, you know, the class code number two. So the class, you know, the classification number two or the ground data. And because of it, when I select like back classification, I say keep classification, and the classification one I'm going to keep is number two. So I'm gonna see it, number two, and I'm gonna see here add. So keep class, so from all this data, I want to keep classification number two. Now I have the outline in here. Now I can add this outline for trimming the data. Yeah, I can say filter, transform, projection, overlay. So the overlay just helps me identify the extent of my data. So in order for me to pick or clip the data based on this outline, I have to here say pick, and I'm pretty much gonna draw an outline just outside of my data. You know, so be, you know, as close as you can, you know, to the outside of the blue line. Yeah. So I define bit one. Now I'm gonna go in the right side. In the right side, in here, I'm gonna say, like, you know, process all the files. And here's the important one, is to say, like, merge files into one. So because, you know, otherwise, you know, if you process, you know, all the files, you're gonna generate individual tiles for each of, like, you know, each section, you know, based on that outline. So what I'm trying to do is, like, I'm trying to merge the data based on this, like, you know, merge the data, like, you know, for the output. So I can see on the output, I'm gonna say the directory here, I'm gonna try to place it in the same location as my other data. I'm gonna say change, and I'm gonna go here to the GIS. I say use current. So it's gonna be first in here. Now here I'm gonna go, let's make a big screen in here. And I'm gonna go here for the format. I'm gonna say here options. Let me see, do I have an option? You have some options in here. Let me see, set version, started point, remove VLR. I don't care about that one. The target projection here is gonna be like the same one as the receiving one. Yeah, so it'd be like in a UTM. It'd be 40 north, so pretty much it'd be 40 north. So it's be in meters, it's all good. And the output format, it's a LS file. You see, like, you know, what's a LAZ file? LAZ is like, it's I guess it's a compressed version of the LS, yeah. So I'm gonna say like merge, like right here, I'm gonna say like in the top, you know, for the finance, so this is the directory. And here I'm gonna put it like, you know, this would be like the topo from topo, I guess, what I call it. LS tools. So with the topo from the LS tools or the ladder from the LS tools. Okay, and I'm gonna say like OTM 14 north, it's all good on my stuff. And I'm gonna say here run 64 because I'm using 64 bit stuff. I'm gonna say here run. Just make sure, you know, before merge, it's all good. And I say here run 64. It pops up with this dialog box in here. And I see here, like, so you see like this one, if you know the commands and stuff, like, you know, the command line, you can run, you know, this line on command line. So LS, you know, pretty much this is the command line, how to make it. But this is the visual one, so it's much easier. I'm gonna say here start. The data is processed. And I should get something at the end. Right there, so there you go, it's processed. Now, if I go back to my C drive, if I go to my GIS, you're gonna see that right in here, by then modified, I have a new topo LS file. Yeah? It's a 32 megabytes topo LS file. Yeah? Now this topo LS file in here, if I go to, you know, for example, to RGS in here, I can go and overlay it in here, kind of look at it, you know, pretty, you know, fast, you know. So I'm gonna show, like, you know, what it looks in here. Let me go in here to GIS. I say here refresh. And I'm gonna look for that new LS file. So I'm gonna go here, topo LS. I'm gonna drag in here. The stuff, you know, opens and stuff. Now this one, it's, again, I said UTM 40 north. If I go here and go to locate and I pick one of these points in here, you're gonna see what happens in here. LS tools, let me see here. Did it do also the elevation adjustment? Because should not be done that one. Let me see in here. So maybe I did something wrong here. No, it looks fine. Okay. So I will obviously data in here. I look at the data. Okay. So now I'm gonna do it here. I'm gonna go pretty much, you know, like, you know, that one, it's a LS file. Yeah, I'm gonna close my R map in here. No, it's just display the version of that one. So I'll go close my R map in here. It's like, okay, so in order for me to bring that data and C3D in here to run it and stuff, you know, I have an LS file. You know, how do I go about, you know, using a format that C3D uses or run, you know, or you can use? And the answer of that one is recap. So I'm going here to the recap. I'm gonna say, you know, start recap. This is part of the AC collection. There you guys start recap. And there you go, the licensing, it's all good. Now recap, I'm gonna say here, click OK. I'm gonna start a new project. So recap, a project gonna import point clouds project. I'm gonna call it in here. I'm gonna call it, this is my topo from LS tools project. Click proceed. Now I'm gonna ask you to select the first import. It's gonna be, you know, we're gonna import that object, pretty much, you know, the new topo right in here in the LS file. Click open that one. Now in here, when I'm gonna go here, I'm gonna go to the advanced. So pretty much, you know, the current, it's, the data comes from 40 North. The target for us, you know, I wanted for it to be like state plane, you know, Texas 83 CF, you know. So pretty much, you know, here is where we do the conversion of the data from meters for vertical to feet, yeah. So I'm gonna go here, loading coordinate system data. It takes a while. I don't know why it takes a while on this stuff. Or maybe, let me see, maybe I can type it in. It's much easier then. Because otherwise it takes a while. So let's see if I type in here TX 80 feet dash CF, right there. Click OK. So it comes from 40 North to, you know, CF. I'm gonna say import files. Now I'm gonna say pretty much you see the stuff, you know, starts, you know, importing pretty much, you know, to the project, the recap project. I'm gonna say index scans. So once it imports the data, it indexes the scan. So it builds, you know, like a new like, you know, index of all the data based on the recap format. Now this one typically, depending on your project, might take, you know, a little bit more. But at the end, you know, you're gonna see that you're gonna have, you know, the option here to launch the project. So pretty much when the index is done, you can open the project, yeah. So now it's another waiting game. Okay. Ooh. Does anybody ever, like, you know, on the meeting here uses recap? Or maybe not. Okay, I'm gonna leave this stuff in here. See the people in the meeting. Yeah. Waiting game. Okay, 60% complete. I've seen a workflow done like with it, like, you know, you actually generate a DM like in QGIS and stuff, but the like, you know, the QGIS DM and stuff requires one of the tools from LS Tools, that's pretty much one of those paid commercial stuff. And I guess in the free version, it's limited to 1.5 million points. So pretty much, you know, you have to kind of trim the data from your LS files to 1.5 million points, like make small batches that you can reassemble afterwards in a new LS file. I don't know, this one here. 60% complete. All right. And my laptop explodes. Okay, 75, finally. It looks like it just takes 2 minutes, 3 minutes. Maybe it's gonna be done by the end of the session. Maybe I can show everything in like 2 minutes, what's done at the end. Or maybe I should have got a smaller area. Okay. Now the issue sometimes you might have, depending on the server, is they use like some kind of server like equipment like LiDAR. If they do not classify the points for you, we're gonna have an issue, because the point cloud, you know, then you're gonna be like all, you're gonna include vegetation, all that stuff. Now SilFiti can, you know, use the whole point cloud, you know, specific, you know, and use some kind of like mechanism that were like, you know, or maybe you're gonna see like when I import the surface, when I create a surface, it provides you an option for you to actually generate the ground based on like some kind of trimming. But this one, you know, because the point cloud is classified for our purposes, we don't have to worry about like classification. Pretty much you just extract, you know, the class number 2, and then we can, you know, process that one. Goodness. Come on, recap. We did this one fast before. Something's running here. Waiting game. Anybody has questions while I wait here? Adam, do you have any other like ways to do it or some stuff, or do you play point clouds, or you just?
No, I don't really get an opportunity to play with point clouds that much.
Okay,
but so do you I'm like doing it? I'm doing it the way you are, Ish, okay. With ArcGIS most of the time. Mm-hmm. I've been, as of late, trying to come up with a workflow that works with recap. The problem I've run into is anything of substantial size, it brings recap to a standstill. I am working off of a little bit older of a computer, so that might be part of the problem, but mm-hmm. Using the LAS tools and the recap is what I've been attempting as of late, but that way there's another way to do it for those that don't have ArcGIS.
Yes, and I'm trying to feel like I'm still playing like stuff since I know that Adam is also like a proponent of QGIS and stuff. I'm trying to feel like if there's any other like stuff in the tools that I'm missing, you know, on this like LS fund and stuff.
So LAS tools has an interface for QGIS, and I've been playing around with it, but I haven't gotten it to work yet. Now, part of that is probably because I'm not as familiar with QGIS as I am with ArcGIS. So I am trying to get that workflow going, because then that gives people a true open source that, you know, that they don't have to pay for. Open source to utilize. Recap, I run into a lot of problems with registration of the coordinate system. Okay. So like if I bring in files from other sources, getting them in the correct coordinate system so that when I go back out, because are you going to take this to an RCS file now?
Yes.
And then bring it in? Yeah. So that's where I'm running into the issue with
So
whether I have a file already or whether I'm bringing in, it's that coordinate system.
Okay. Yeah, so if you look at this stuff right now, like, you know, you're going to see, like, if I put my mouse around here, you're going to see, like, in the corner is the coordinates. Now, this coordinates by meters and all that stuff. Now, I can go in here, like, you know, in the options, if you want to display coordinates in a different stuff, you can go here in the options. You can go here to the units, where the units, project the units. Okay, let me see, general. That's good. So, if I go in here, like, the project unit, you're going to see, like, you know, feet. And you're going to see, like, you click OK, and you're going to see the data, you know, displayed in feet, yeah. For 75. So pretty much it just, you know, it does your, I mean, like the data, it's still in, the data is still in meters. I mean, but the software, you know, in the background, it's like, oh, this is feet, you know? I mean, like it is like, you know, this is the elevation of feet. It does the whole scaling. But you know, right now it's like, I'm done with stuff here. Now in here, you could technically, you can say like, you know, do like limit boxing. You can even go further and stuff before you export to, you know, to an RCS. But for my purpose here, I'm going to just go here and export to an RCS. I'm going to click here on the export. Now here you can ask you which format you want to do it. You know, you can use RCP, you know, but the RCP requires, you know, this folder. The RCS is more or less like, you know, like a what's called the zip version of it. You know, pretty much it's like all in one cat file, you know, versus, you know, like an index of the data into folder. So I'm going to see a unified RCS, and I'm going to see like, you know, this, I'm going to say topo, LS tools. Tools like that. It's RSpec, click save. Let's unify a project. It's all good on the stuff. You can go here, unify settings, and say something and stuff. But for now, you know, I don't care about it. I just want to export the project. Now, once you export the project, what you're going to get again, it's an RCS file. Pretty much you get it's a unified stuff there. Now, let me see if I go in here and look at the data a little bit. Kind of give an idea. If I go here to the top LS tool support, you're gonna see in the background in here that before you export to an RCS, actually the RCP itself, this one is an index file, but the data that actually showing it's an RCS file. So pretty much the RCP file in itself is pointing to the RCS file that's inside of this one. The only stuff that I'm doing right now is pretty much I'm duplicating the data by exporting it out. Yeah. But when I export this stuff, you know, I should export it in the coordinate system and projection that I define for the output. That's important. Yeah, you have the RCS in the folder of the RCP folder, but you know, this one, it's a different one. Pretty much I do the whole reproduction of data. So if I go in here, if I go to minimize, you know, my my this one in here, I'm gonna go to my project in here. I'm gonna go to the start menu, and I'm gonna make a new. I'm gonna make a new file, pretty much from the same template. I'm gonna say right in here. Now this one, I'm gonna delete, you know, the data that I have in here, pretty much, you know, this stuff that's my part of my template. And I'm gonna be like in here, and I'm gonna go like this, delete. And I'm gonna say save, pretty much I start with saving here. I'm gonna say this one is to be surface LS tools. All right, I'm gonna save. Now in here, what I'm gonna do in here, I'm gonna do the first things first, I'm gonna go to the, pretty much you can reference here the CAD file if you want, the XREF. I'm gonna attach here the CAD file. So you can have an idea like where's your data. And I say here overlay. Now typically you see like all my templates here, the user unit list. I do not use feet, I do not use meters, I do not use inches, but all my CAD files were set up all the way to unit list. So pretty much there's no place for, let's say like something, you know, getting in, like, you know, being scaled by such stuff. So pretty much, you know, all my base files, these unit list. Zoom extend. So I have the data right in here, that's pretty much my data. I'm gonna go here to the, what I'm gonna do here. First things first, for you to create a surface from an LAS file, or no, from an RCS file, you have to, right in here, you have to attach the RCS file to your, you know, to your stuff. So I'm gonna go here to extend references, XREF. I go in the drop down, I'm gonna attach a point cloud. And the point cloud I'm gonna attach in here, gonna be the RCS. Right in here, click open. Hopefully gonna work. If everything works fine. Now here's the relative path. I do not change anything here. It's like pretty much that stuff. I'm gonna click okay. And right there, I should have like, you know, the RCS file, but within this one in here. So this RCS file in here is like pretty much it's available. You're gonna see that as soon as you bring an RCS file, it changes the display from a 2D wireframe to a 3D wireframe. It always does that one. So pretty much, you know, for it to display the point. So now I'm gonna go here to the surface. I'm gonna say here, create a surface from a point cloud. Select the point cloud, I'm gonna say here by window, because you know, sometimes, you know, it does select this. I'm gonna say select this one right in here. Now here, change my name, I'm gonna say like, this is my V topo, right there, V underscore topo, right there. Say next. Now here, guys, here, like, you know, how many points? This is like, you know, all of them selected and stuff. I'm gonna say next. Now here's like, you know, if you did not have a classified, like, you know, only the ground shots, here have the option to say filter. So pretty much you see like, you know, can use this stuff. It gives you an idea how it generates, you know, the ground data. Pretty much just stuff. For me, it's like, you know, I don't have to use any filter, just use all the points because I already know the background data. So I say create surface. Now here, this is selected point clouds have been processed, blah, blah, blah. It does a stop at all, it processes the background and it generates your surface. Now once the surface is generated and stuff, right there, I guess I get a couple of events. And it builds the data. I'm gonna click here on minus on our mug shots in here. I'm gonna see like in there. Now you hear, I have the surface created. I'm gonna go to the tool space, extend references. I'm gonna go here to the LS part and say unload. And I'm gonna change this one here to display to the 2D wireframe because I like this stuff 2D wireframe. And right there, it's like point cloud are not displayed in this visual style. I do not care about that one, so if it's displayed or not in that style. So there you go, I have my surface and the elevation to this one, it's in feet. So pretty much, you know, it's like it's in the right location, it's in feet, you know, and I can do that stuff. Of course, I can go here to geolocation, turn on my aerial, and you know, it should look the right way. I mean, the stuff right there, you have the surface, you know, stuff, pretty much that stuff. The difference in between this one and the other one is that this one pretty much you use all the points, you know, it's not on a grid. Pretty much you use all the points in here. So if I turn on here the triangles, you're gonna see pretty much you use every point. Now this one might not look the right way for like for your what's called for your engineer, because you know the engineer might want, you know, like, you know, hey, I want it to be curvy, you know, and stuff, but you know, it's like this one is like, so the idea is like this one, you know, typically I go one step further. So for example, like, you know, the step that I typically do in here is like, you know, based on this surface, I can generate points on the surface on a grid and then use those points to generate me a new surface, yeah? So I don't know if for most of the people, this is the final step and stuff, you have a surface. For me, I can go an extra step in here. Like for example, it's like if I want data in this, like, you know, in this area right in here, I can go here to like, let's say I can go here to points creation tools. I'm gonna do the following. So I'm gonna go here to the default layer. So the default layer is fine. Points creation is good. I'm gonna say here like a pump till elevation. I say like, you know, I say automatic. This one I say automatic. I'm gonna say this one will be automatic. So pretty much we're stopping here. Default elevation, I don't care. Default description, I put natural ground. So there you go. So pretty much, you know, I define, you know, we stop everything is automatic. And then I'm gonna go into drop down list and I say here is like on a grid. So pretty much I'm gonna put points on a grid. Pretty much I'm sampling this surface on a grid and I'm gonna use the new points as a source for my final surface. So select the surface, I'm gonna select this surface. Specify the grid points, so maybe I'm gonna work on this area right in here because I do not want to process all of this stuff. It might take me a while and, you know, this beyond stuff. So I'm gonna use it from here. I'm gonna say from here, this is my base point. The grid rotation will be zero, it's fine. The grid spacing, I'll put like, you know, sample every 10 feet and drive it 10 by 10. The upper location, I'll say maybe sample it up to here. Rather, change the size and rotation of the grid. I'll say like no, rather. And you can see like in the background, see feed what it does, it generates me a couple of points. Now these points are generated on grid and have the elevation of pretty much, we have the elevation of the surface that you'll sample from, yeah? So now if I go in here to like the tool space, I go to surfaces, and I go here to the surface properties and I change this one to not display. I'll say here, no display, rather. You can delete it at this moment pretty much and you can say like, you know, do not use it. So I have this point. I'm gonna go in here and I'm gonna go to my point groups and you're gonna see that I will be stopping. I'm gonna say just update this one. And because the view topo, the original one already has this stuff added, you know, like that point group added, the DTM, I can rebuild this stuff in here. And there you go. I have my surface built from LiDAR points sampled. So pretty much, you know, this one, it's easier to like, you know, to manage versus the one from the point cloud, yeah. Now, this one, you could even go a step further in like exporting this up to like an XYZ file and pretty much use the same workflow that I had, you know, from the RGS Pro, you know. So pretty much, you know, there's like, you know, it's like some people, like, you know, if they're used to the, what's called the LDD mode, the land desktop mode, where the data is stored outside and it was generated inside. Typically for CL3D, for management of data, I try to keep, you know, the data outside and just, you know, link it and generate the data inside, yeah? So I do not want to, you know, use the points in here and then build the surface because it's pretty much doubling the data. So typically I try to keep this data out and then use it, you know, to generate the data in, yeah. So this is how I do it, you know, it's, you know, pretty much, you know, you can generate the data, you know, much better. You can, to this one, you know, if you have like some brake lines, you can add brake lines and stuff, you know, to kind of, you know, stuff, you know, based on the aerial, like, you know, proximity brake lines. So on this one, I can say like, maybe on here, I can say, maybe I can define a power line here, there you go on the aerial. I can say like, you know, this is my, let's say more like this, rather like this, with my edge of the road. Of course, this one is not as accurate, of course, you know, as the guys, you know, that goes in the field and does it. But, you know, I can go here to the tool space. I'm gonna go here to the V topo brake lines. I'm gonna say here add, and I'm gonna say here proximity. And I said like, this should be like brake lines, rather brake lines. I click okay. And I'm gonna use, you know, these two brake lines, the proximity brake lines. And that one should update, you know, my data, right, you know, in that area pretty much to, you know, add that brake line, yeah. That's all I have for today. If anybody has questions, I guess we can ask them. Otherwise, I guess that's all I tried to show, so. Good, Adam?
Looks good.
That was good, thanks, Ish. I don't have any questions. Anybody else?
I have questions, but it's things I can do after. Like I said, I've run into a lot of issues with the getting that coordinate system to work. But yeah. You say you do everything unitless to get it in?
Yeah, typically I put unitless, you know, because, you know, unitless, you know, it doesn't pass. Sometimes, you know, you don't want to deal with international US survey feed, US survey feed, all that stuff. I don't want to, I just want to be like clear the way it comes from that one. So pretty much the idea is here's like, you know, the, like, yes, you see, like, you know, my CAD file is set up to unitless, yeah? But my coordinate system to the CAD file is still stapling, yeah? So pretty much everything is in feed. It's only that the unit for the CAD file is to unitless all the time.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
All right, I might have to play around with that then. Okay.
Anybody stuff in chat? Okay, looks like everything is good. Yeah. So pretty much I can look at this stuff, you know, and I mean, maybe later, you know, I'm gonna, you know, push more of this stuff, you know, and see what we can do for QGIS and other stuff to see, like, maybe we can do better. Maybe we can even do like classification or stuff, but yeah, there's something like, you know, dreamland for now, classification. So.
Nope, that's good stuff. Thank you. Thank you for that, Ish.
Okay. I guess.